we continue to worship online. I would apologize for any intermittent service. We are doing our very best. We've installed extenders to our Wi-Fi service, working with our vendor here in Commerce. And so I do apologize for any interruptions in service, and we welcome your feedback. The flowers in the sanctuary today are placed to the glory of Almighty God and in memory of Mrs. Joyce Dunson on the occasion of her birthday by daughters Barbara Bender and Miriam Dunson. Tells us, come to Jesus, you who are thirsty. Drink deeply of the Holy Spirit. Let your heart overflow with the living water that renews the face of the earth. Friends, let us open our worship service by responsibly giving our call to worship using the words printed in our order of worship. As the Creator and Savior are one, may we all be one. So that the world will see Christ, may we all be one. So that the nations will know the love of God for them, may we all be one. As the body of Christ for the sake of the world,
may we all be one.
Together, let us worship God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Friends, let us sing our hymn of praise number 371, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less.
Thank you.
friends, God has promised that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Therefore, let us responsibly call upon the Lord, confessing our sins. Take time for our silent confession and receive the gift of His grace with our assurance of forgiveness. Creator God, breathing life into our being, You gave us the gift of life. You placed us on this earth and gave us the gift of peoples, of cultures, race, and colors to love, to care for, to share our lives with. Today You ask us, where is your brother, your sister? We hide ourselves in shame and fear. Poverty, hunger, hatred, and war rule the earth. The refugees, the oppressed, and the voiceless cry out to You. Forgive us, O God of love, and reconcile us to Yourself and to one another. Teach us, O Creator God of love, that the earth and all its fullness are Yours, the world and those who dwell in it. Restore in us the joy of our salvation. Call us yet again to safeguard the gift of life through Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ, and Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone. A new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven and be at peace. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Friends, just having received the peace of Christ, share that same peace with those that are gathered with you today.
The peace of Christ be with you.
The peace of Christ be with each of you.
Thank you.
Pray with me. Almighty God, you opened the meaning of the scriptures to the disciples on the road to Emmaus. Gave their hearts a strange, warm feeling. Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, warm our hearts as we hear your word proclaimed, that we may receive you with joy. Amen. Friends, if you have your Bibles with you this morning, if you would open them to the book of Psalms, to Psalm 116. We're going to be reading verses 1 through 4 and verses 12 through 19 for our Old Testament lesson this morning. Let us hear the word of God as the psalmist proclaims that our gathering each Sunday for worship is a thankful response and not a repayment for what God has done for each and every one of us. Psalm 116, verses 1 through 4. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications. Because he inclined his ear to me, therefore I will call on him as long as I live. The snares of death encompassed me, the pangs of Sheol laid hold on me. I suffered distress and anguish. And I called on the name of the Lord. O Lord, I pray, save my life. And then, friends, you'll go down to verses 12 through 19. What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful ones. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant, the child of your serving girl. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer to you a thanksgiving sacrifice and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the house of the Lord, in the midst, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord. And if you'll turn over to our New Testament reading, from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. Again, hear God's word as Jesus appears to two believers walking on the road to the village to Emmaus. Now, on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. Jesus said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "You're the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days." Jesus asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning. When they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see him." Then Jesus said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, how slow of heart to believe all the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, Jesus interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. they came near the village to which they were going, Jesus walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So Jesus went in to stay with them. He was at the table with them. Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized Jesus, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed. He has appeared to Simon." And they told what happened on the road, and Jesus had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. Friends, here ends our lessons. These are the words of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, friends, the past 90 days have been very busy with news. Coverage of the COVID-19 outbreak and what all is being done to curb its spread, the number of cases and deaths, work on a vaccine, news of opening things back up, and lots of COVID-19. You know, I would bet there was lots and lots of news leading up to our gospel lesson over 2,000 years ago. The story of these two believers and their encounter with the risen Lord on the road to Emmaus is one of the most well-known and beautiful accounts in all of our gospel lessons. What starts out as a couple of followers of Jesus traveling out of Jerusalem on the road to Emmaus, and it ends with a revelation confirming Jesus' resurrection. Now, Emmaus was located about 7 miles outside of Jerusalem, a rather short distance by today's standards, but back then it would have been a much longer journey. Now, the town itself was rather insignificant. In fact, its ruins are yet to be found, but yet its journey with Jesus and these two believers is what really puts Emmaus on the map of historical importance. And you see, it's Jesus' appearance to these two believers on the road to Emmaus as an ever-presence in the lives of all believers that is the takeaway of Luke's gospel story. Now, I know that many of us today have memories of the news reports of the assassination of President John Kennedy, the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King, the bombing of the U.S. Federal Building in Oklahoma City, 9/11 and the attack on the Twin Towers in New York City, the Pentagon, the explosion of the Deepwater Horizon oil rig, which celebrates its 10-year anniversary this month. Of course, the world in the last 90 days, to which I mentioned in my introduction, and certainly many of us still mourn the loss of a close friend and our family member. Our anxiety levels start to climb. We're not thinking straight, and we start asking ourselves, is all this going to really matter in 10 years? How about 5 years from now, next year, next week? We start to hide our grief and our despair, and so our faith journey kind of hits a glitch in our hopes and our dreams, and we get a little sense of what our two believers might have felt like when they walked along this road to Emmaus on that day. And so I would imagine that the very last person that they expected to encounter was the risen Lord. So therefore, they did not see him. Now, for sure, we know two things. One, that they are indeed headed out of town, and number two, Jesus joins them. But at first, they did not know who he was. Well, you and I know who he is. We know the full story. We know that this stranger is the risen Jesus, but these two did not recognize him. And so we've got to ask ourselves, why didn't they recognize him? Did Jesus somehow look different? I don't think so. I think something else must be going on here. And so we need to revisit verse 16 of our reading. But they did not know who he was because God kept them from recognizing him. Did God suddenly take away their sight? Did these two suddenly come up empty? Or were they just suddenly thick as a brick? Folks, the fact is that our two believers did not recognize Jesus is very critical to our lesson and is a significant piece of our tool bag that we carry with us on our faith journey today. And so what it tells me is that Jesus walks with us today even when we don't recognize him. You see, the Road to Emmaus lesson tells us that if we don't look for Jesus, we will likely walk right by him. You see, this walk that Jesus took with these two believers shows the divine power and the loving nature of Jesus Christ. You see, he just doesn't come up and get right in their faces. He doesn't come down the road skipping and doing cartwheels and knocking these folks on their backsides. But Jesus comes up quietly and unobtrusively. He comes up, he walks with them, he listens, he joins in them in their conversation. He wants to know what is really meaningful to them. And as he does so often and so very well, Jesus gives them some instruction on interpreting the scriptures and how the prophets foretold all that had occurred during the previous days, and that it was important for them to understand why it was necessary for these things to happen to the Messiah, and that for them to understand that all the scripture and the prophets were pointing to the Messiah, Jesus of Nazareth, the Son of God. You see, Jesus is showing his care, his concern. Folks, he did it with the two on the road to Emmaus, and he does it with us right today, tomorrow, next week, next year, and for all eternity. Even after this rather lengthy walk and learning moment, these two still didn't get it. Well, they finally make it to Emmaus. The sun is slowly disappearing in the west. Darkness is settling in. And so what was so often the case back then, the two believers invite Jesus to break bread with them. Jesus was reluctant at first, but he finally accepts their invitation. They step in. They sit around the table. And these eyes of these believers finally were open to who had been their traveling companion. He sits down. There's bread on the table. Jesus gives thanks for the gathering. He gives thanks for the food that we're about to receive. He takes the bread that's on the table. He breaks the bread. He gives it to them. And all of a sudden, it happens in that very instant. Suddenly, their eyes were open, and they recognized him. And it all comes together for these two. They finally get it. They finally understand, and they turn to one another. And in verse 32, they understand, and they say to each other, Didn't our hearts feel strangely warm as he talked to us on the road and explained the scriptures to us? Friends, could Luke's message be more on target? Each day, every day, and everyone we meet, family, friend, neighbor, stranger, co-worker, the risen Christ is with us always. And what is even more amazing is, folks, Christ is always on standby. He's waiting to hear from us because he wants to hear from us. He wants us to bring him our joys, our concerns. Christ wants to give his voice to our fears and our anxieties. You see, what concerns us is a concern to him. Now, we may not always get the answer we want, but by golly, we will get the answer that we need. All too often, Christ is ignored. He is not recognized. We couldn't pick him out of a lineup. In fact, for most of us, Christ is only a Sunday morning worship servant presence at best, and on occasion, and then lost in the racking and stacking of all the other things that we got going on the Sabbath. Folks, this is not God's plan, and this is not how he designed us to be. You see, he designed us to be and live in the risen Christ all the time, and not just some of the time. Have you heard of this application called Life 360? You can download it on your iPhone. Well, we have it all on the Cain account, and it allows us to keep track of the whereabouts of one another. It's very frustrating to our adult children, but it's a great thing to have in light of all the criminal activity lurking about in all our communities. Well, part of the application is that I, Daddy Roe, will get a text message reminders when either Trina, Bo's, or Gracie's phone is low on their battery charge to remind them to plug it in to recharge their battery so that the phone can continue to receive and engage. I mean, what a great reminder. After all, the iPhone in Life 360 is worthless if the battery is dead. So I started to think, wouldn't it be a great reminder if our souls got a reminder to recharge and be ready to recognize the risen Christ in our daily walk, so that we would be prepared to receive and engage Him? After all, Jesus promises. He promises in Matthew chapter 28, verse 20, to be with us always. Jesus' words, "And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Folks, Jesus is with us now, and much like the two on the road to Emmaus, we fail to recognize Him. Our battery is dead. You see, in order to recognize Jesus, we need to be engaged, and it is not particularly painful or difficult, but it needs to take a commitment, and it needs practice, daily practice, connecting with the risen Lord and staying connected with Him, and seeking ways to spread the good news, reaching out to those in need, and making disciples of those we meet. The key to our success is praying ceaselessly. Part of it is spoken, but the majority of it is how we live out our lives, folks. Start out our day with Christ. Give Him our joys, our concerns. Ask Him to help us out, to work out our anger and our resentments. Ask Him for forgiveness. Ask Him for strength to forgive others. So what is it we are doing each day to look for Christ? To not only see Him, but to recognize Him, to welcome Him and to embrace Him. Folks, Jesus is with us right today, and so what are we going to do about it? Well, it's very simple. All we have to do is look for Him, engage Him, and we will find Him. He is only a prayer away. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Friends, our hymn of response is number 391, the first four verses of Take My Life.
Thank you.
Friends, having just heard God's word read and proclaimed, let us profess what we believe using a portion of the brief statement of faith. Together, we trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the children, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the death of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to life eternal. Amen. Friends, as we prepare our hearts to go to God in prayer, Melanie Kress rebroke her left foot going down the stairs, so we pray for Melanie. The doctor's got to be back in a boot, so we pray for Melanie during this very stressful time. But friends, the congregation as a whole is in great shape, despite a few minor bumps in the road with some broken wrist and, of course, Melanie with her broken foot. So continue to pray for our flock during this very difficult time as we make our way through this COVID-19. The Westminster Larger Catechism asked question number 178. What is prayer? Answer: prayer is an offering up of our desires unto God in the name of Christ, by the help of his Spirit, with the confession of our sins and thankful acknowledgement of his mercy. Therefore, friends, let us settle our hearts and open our minds as we offer up our joys and concerns to God. With the help of the Holy Spirit, confess our sins and give thanks to God's mercy. The Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the opportunity of sharing this Sunday in your church at Commerce Presbyterian Church. Lord, in this new day, allow us to live by faith, knowing that your will be with us in our travels, in our words, in our actions, in our relationship with others and with you. God of mercy and judgment, we come to you because there is no better time or place to give you our joys and our concerns, and to ask for your action in changing the world around us. Lord, we pray for those places in the world that suffer for lack of food and water. Give the world and its leaders the wisdom they need and the resources they lack, so that no one suffers needlessly. We pray for those who suffer through natural or human-made disasters. Let every one of us be part of a world so that through prayer and possessions we may help to restore order and well-being. We pray for those who lack a home because of economic hardship or unjust forces. Lord, use each of us to build a better future for all. You are a merciful, and you are just. Both your righteousness and justice fill your love for your people. Enable us to actively seek your love and justice for all creatures of this earth. Lord, as we look forward to needed rest, we thank you for allowing us to stand through the storms of problems and feelings that each day brings. When we lay our heads to rest, let us breathe prayerfully so that the strength we gain during the night may fill us with hope and love for a new day and new opportunities. Lord, we pray for our military men and women and our community's first responders. Be with them as they move in and out of harm's way. We pray for our neighbors grieving the loss of loved ones, those neighbors facing medical procedures and uncertainties, those neighbors seeking a job. May they lean on you for comfort and reassurance. Lord, we lift up our prayer for our entire world as we continue to fight the good fight against COVID-19. Shore up the medical personnel who heroically continue to treat those infected. Our first responders who stand watch protecting our communities, the folks who continue to sanitize common areas, the scientific community who are working to come up with an effective vaccine, our leaders who are making very difficult decisions for the good of us all, our families who have lost loved ones to this disease. Lord, as we all take measured steps to reopen, may we be patient at all times, persistent always, and praying ceaselessly that our focus is on you and moving forward as you lead us to calm waters. Almighty God, into your hands we trust our being, very being. Hear our prayer in the name of the one who is our rock and our foundation, Jesus Christ, who taught us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Almighty God invites us to live in gratitude by offering what God has already given us. Would the ushers please come forward for the gathering of our tithes and our offerings? In gratitude for your astounding goodness. Make our lives to be an acceptable offering in union with our risen Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you forever. Amen. Friends, our sending hymn is number 372, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian.
Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart.
Friends, as I envisioned all of you being assembled in God's house this morning, I'm reminded that none of us, not any of us, could be who we are, where we are, without the guiding, loving presence who appeared to the two on the road to Emmaus. Wherever our life's roads may take us from here, with all the twists and turns, the long straightaways, the steep hills, and the easy descents, our risen Lord guides us. He walks with us and shows us the way. So friends, let us go forth in the joy of the risen Lord to recharge our souls, be obedient to the truth, be genuine in love to the living and enduring Word of God. And may the grace of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord, the loving God who raised him from the dead, and the power of the Holy Spirit who fills the world with new life, bless us and keep us now and forever.